It is delightful to see you all this morning and wonderful to see you come in and just share with one another the greetings of a beautiful, beautiful day in the Lord's house. Always want to pray that indeed you will feel God's presence in our time together and that you will rejoice that you have chosen to be in the house of the Lord. As we look at our announcements this morning, we always want to invite any first-time guests that might be with us to stop by the Welcome Center that's over in the East Vestibule. There's a gift that awaits you. And it's always just a nice opportunity to get to share with one another. So please keep that in mind. Today, at the end of the worship service, we will be collecting for the Benevolent Fund. And in case there is not someone at the door with the basket, I take money. You know, don't go away with your money in your hand. I'll take it, okay? So sometimes we have people going, who's taking the money? And I just go, I am. Tomorrow, the Spirit of Love class will be going to Richardson's for lunch. The bus will be leaving at 11 here from the church. The Wednesday night activities are in your bulletin. The after-school program has started for this session. The menu is in the bulletin. We will have the Bible study and choir practice. If you're interested in staying for Dr. Coming for dinner, that is on the bulletin board as well. You can sign up for that. On the 10th of February, we have the Mid-Tide Water Intercessory Prayer Meeting. That will be in Glebe Landing Church. The bus leaves here at 6, and it does pick up at Saluda at 6:15. So if you've not joined that group, if you would like to, just come and we'll be glad for you to be a part of the intercessory prayer. On the 13th of February, the Joy Club will meet here in the Fellowship Hall. Also wanted to announce that the Joy Club is planning a meeting to go to Lancaster for the play Esther. This will take place in May. But in order to reserve the tickets for the play, we need the $70 by next Sunday. Is that correct, Becky? Okay. So if you're interested in going with the Joy Club and that for that play, please get your money in and Becky will be receiving that. I think we're giving Faye a little bit of a break here for a brief time, just so you know it's going to be brief.
Pick it back up tomorrow.
Thank you, David. On Saturday the 15th, there's a musical fundraiser that's happening at the middle school, St. Clair Walker Middle School. And this is indeed for the rebuilding of St. Paul's Baptist Church up in Jamaica, Virginia, that is. So if you are interested in that, you'd like to come, there are a lot of local groups that they have planned. I know there was information in the Sentinel this week. If you've received the Sentinel, you can check that out. They're looking for donations, of course, in the concert to help with this rebuilding. There's more information if you're interested that's also on the bulletin board. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? Let's prepare our hearts and minds to worship God.
Thank you.
Tony, for the call to worship printed in your bulletin. I'll read the light print if you'll then read the bold. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all.
Oh, send out your light, your truth.
Let him lead me. We will continue with our praise time and dedicate to the coming witness.
If you'll stand with me and watch the screens.
You can look around a little bit if you want. Energy is good.
Father, we come into your presence this morning, grateful that we can indeed acknowledge the might that you have. Father, the scriptures remind us that your hand is not shortened in our day, that you are, Father, capable of doing all the mighty things that you have done down through the ages through your people. And so we praise you, Father. We praise you for your presence here in this place. We praise you, Father, for your presence in our lives each and every day. And Father, as we gather together, we pray that indeed all that we do and say here in our service this morning will bring the honor and glory to your name that is due. We thank you, Father. We thank you for the love that you have shown to us through Jesus Christ, your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our hymn of praise is hymn number 405. Have faith in God, first, second, and fourth verses. Thank you. Before we come to the time of prayers of the people, there's a recognition that I'd like to make and to ask Brenda if she'd come forward, please. Brenda has been working hard over the past few years. When exactly did you start all these courses?
October 2017.
All right, in October of 2017, she set out on the journey to become certified for children's and youth ministry, and now I think it's family ministries, and pretty soon she's going to take my job, I think. But that'll be all right, because I'm looking to retire anyway. There you go. But indeed, it's a wonderful accomplishment that Brenda has been working on these courses, and they list for you all that she has taken, the family of God, the development, ages and stages, teaching techniques and approaches, Bible study basics, best practices of teaching preschoolers, children's ministry, best practices of teaching children, choosing and evaluating children's curriculum, and she has indeed completed this certificate, which is presented to her from the Baptist General Association of Virginia. It says the Ministry Equipping Network of the Baptist General Association of Virginia presents this certificate to Brenda Armstrong in recognition of the successful completion of the Children's Ministry Certification and her calling to guide children, parents, and their leaders to know and make God known. This is signed by John Upton and by Susan McBride, and we do want to present this to Brenda. Congratulations. One more glass to go. We are just very, very proud of what she does, and I know that as she does, completes her work, and you know, there will be opportunities that I know God is already at work and preparing a place that He'd call her, you know, and I tell her I'm praying for God's will in her life reluctantly, but you know, that's just upfront, honest stuff here, you know, but we want God indeed to work in your life and bring about exactly what He has for each and every one of us, which is our prayer for all. So Brenda, congratulations, and we are very, very proud of you.
As a parent in the youth group, I would like to say to Brenda, thank you very much for using the tools that she has learned with our children and youth every Sunday.
Thank you.
And she knows that's what I want to keep hold up, by the way. All right, as we move to our prayer of the people, I always give you an opportunity to share anything that you might have witnessed this week or experienced that says God is still alive and well in our midst. Is there anything that you'd like to share?
Barbara.
Yes.
Brown had a successful knee replacement. He's home with Babe, and physical therapist is coming to the house. He still has to learn to walk a little better.
Don't we all?
And we'll certainly keep him in our prayers, and we're glad that God's called him
for
the surgery. All right, anyone else?
Barbara.
Yes.
I was lucky to tell y'all a few weeks ago that Sherry McQuillan, who was on our prayer list, was cancer-free after all of her treatments. But I found out this week her husband, Matt, had a severe heart attack. So you'll keep that family in your prayers. He's from Gloucester. He's the owner of Max Motors in Gloucester, and they're a very nice family.
All right. Are there any other that you need to add to our prayer list or updates for those that are there? Yes?
Barbara, Mama, as you know, took a pretty bad fall. She's still recuperating, but she is very blessed because she did not break any bones. It could have been a lot worse. So continued prayers would be appreciated.
All right, thank you. And we're certainly keeping her in our prayers for total healing. All right, are there others?
years were up.
All right, thank you. Yes, David?
Janet Neal, that I went to school with, she's got a hernia with the long name about this long. She has some more testing coming up at MCV before they're able to do surgery. So just keep her in your prayers. I asked to put her on her prayer list, and she said, by all means.
Okay. All right. Are there any others? Let us go to God in prayer. Almighty and most merciful Father, we come to your throne of grace this morning, lifting up our prayers of thanksgiving. Thankful, Father, for just the knowledge of who you are that has been revealed to us in Christ Jesus and through the scriptures. Thankful, Father, that indeed through your Holy Spirit, you act within our lives and stir up, Father, those desires to know you better. Father, we are thankful indeed for all of the blessings that you shower upon us, for we know, Lord, that we are indeed a blessed people. You provide, Father, every good and perfect gift, the scripture says, that comes from above. That all that we have and all that we are, and Father, all that we will ever be is certainly a gift from you. And so, Father, we thank you for our homes. We thank you for the food and the clothing and all the material things that, Father, you provided for us to make our lives more comfortable. And, Father, we hear your word that tells us that when we do it unto the least of one of these, we have done it unto you. You challenge us, Father, indeed, to share out of our abundance with those who are less fortunate than ourselves. And so, Father, we pray that indeed in all ways we will be faithful and obedient to your will. And, Father, we know that you created us to be within relationships. You created us to be in a relationship with you, that you are our Father, the one who created us, the one who redeems us, sustains us, the one who is our all in all through Christ Jesus. So, Father, we thank you for families, for you created us to be in those relationships. You called us, Father, to be loving and supporting and caring to one another. And, Lord, you've given to us good friends that walk along beside us as well, that see us through the difficult times, that Father can indeed send those cards and phone calls and texts and visits and food and all that, Lord, just speaks that there is care. And care, Father, because you have cared for us. And Father, we thank you for our church family. Lord, for those who walk beside us in faith. Father, those who indeed know you as we know you and recognize, Father, the blessings that come from being your faith community, those who indeed encourage the poor and love, Father, one another. And Lord, we thank you for prayer. We thank you that your word encourages us to come to you with all of our desires and with all of our concerns and with all of our heart. And you will hear our prayers, Father. And so, Father, we lift up to you those that are on our prayer list. And the prayer list, Father, of our sister churches up and down the highways. And Father, we ask that you would address the concerns of the heart of the people that haven't even voiced the things that disturb them the most. You know their concerns. We pray, Father, that you would indeed bless them. And at this time, with a sense of your presence and knowing that there are those who are praying for them, that they are in the center of your attention. And Lord, we pray that indeed we will continue to minister to them as you call us to do. And Lord, we now ask that indeed you would bless this time, a time of worship, a time of praise, a time of study of your word. That Father, when we leave from this place, we will be glad that we have been in the house of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all of the love that you shower upon us through the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we make our prayer. Amen. Our offertory hymn is hymn number 317, Only Trust Him, verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you. blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, reading verses 35 through 41. Listen to God's word. And on that day, when the evening had come, he said to his disciples, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with them. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat upon the boat, so that the boat was already becoming swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Let us pray together. Father, we ask that indeed, that as we come to your word and as it speaks to our heart, Father, we will find the encouragement and the strength and, yes, Father, even the challenge that there may lie within it for each and every one of us. Lord, your word tells us that it never goes out and returns to you void. And so, Father, we claim that promise in Jesus' name. Amen. After Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River by John the Baptist, and he hears that voice as the heavens open up and says, "This is my son, the beloved, the one in whom I am well pleased." And remember, we talked about those 40 days he spent in the wilderness before Satan came indeed to tempt him and keep him from following his Father's will. And then we know that after that, the scriptures tell us that Jesus begins his ministry. He begins to proclaim, "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." We find that recorded in the book of Mark in the first chapter, verse 15. And Jesus' ministry indeed was one of teaching and preaching and healing. And that ministry has indeed begun. The setting for our text today is on the Sea of Galilee. Here in our community, we know a little bit about water. We seem to be surrounded by it. There's not much distance that you travel without crossing a bridge, right? And typically, if you're crossing a bridge, that means what?
Water.
Water, right? You've got to get across. So we're surrounded by water. We're surrounded by those rivers and creeks that we remember so very well. And so many of us have experience of being out on those waters. And I remember when I was a child, as a matter of fact, that we were out on the Rappahannock River. We always went out on a Sunday afternoon. That was about the only time that my father, who was a waterman, had time for the family. And so that was our time. We were out on the Rappahannock fishing. It was a beautiful, beautiful day. It was sunny and bright and calm could be. And then all of a sudden, my father announces that we are to pull up our lines, for he has seen something that we totally missed. And he heads for Lockless Creek, about as fast as that work boat would take us. And as we were traveling, that storm began to whip up. You all that live on the water, you know how quickly it comes. And that waves were actually flapping over the bow of that boat as we came. So if it's coming over the bow of the boat, it's coming into the boat, right? It was an interesting occasion. I don't have the good sense to be afraid. I'm just going to say that right up front. I thought it was the neatest experience that I had ever had. But later I learned that there might have been just a tad bit of danger there in that situation. But I know that it was probably because I had great faith in this waterman, my father, and that it was all going to be well. And so I also remember another experience that I had on the water, and that was taking an excursion on the Sea of Galilee when I was fortunate enough to go with a group from Harmony Grove to the Holy Land. And it was a calm, calm day when we were out. And indeed, it was a beautiful, beautiful day. But the day that I experienced on that Sea of Galilee was indeed the exact opposite from what we are seeing here in our text today. It indeed was late in the evening, we are told. It had been a long day of Jesus' preaching and teaching about the kingdom of God. And he was preaching to them in parables. You can go back and read it in the earlier chapters. And at the end of the day, Jesus says to his disciples that they are going to get in the boat and they are going to cross the sea to the other side. But you know, that calmness didn't last so very long. Very soon, a great and violent storm, we are told, happens. It comes about. And if we read and study about the lay of the land around the Sea of Galilee, that was not extremely unusual. There was something about the way the winds would whip down through that terrain and just begin to beat and bang. So the wind and the waves were beating upon the boat. And Mark tells us that the boat was beginning quickly to be swamped. You know, that sort of, we're going down kind of a deal. And the disciples, you know, most of these men are seasoned fishermen. They're watermen. They are accustomed to being on the sea. And so we know that they have spent much time on those waters, and they recognized the danger. They recognized the danger that they faced. Can't you envision in your mind them with whatever was available in that boat, scooping water and throwing it back into the sea, and they're not winning the battle? You know, there's more water coming in than they can possibly scoop up and throw out. And so they know that indeed this situation is not good. The possibilities indeed are threatening. And they recognize their inability to control the situation. Their inability to control the situation. They are seasoned fishermen who realize, wow, it's beyond us. What do we do? So my friends, let's face it, it is panic time. You know, they are confronted by fear, real sheer terror. They are confronted by forces that are far more powerful than anything that they can handle. So what do you do? Well, what about Jesus? Now where is he? He is on board. He hasn't bailed ship. Oh, yeah. He's asleep. He's up in the stern of the boat with his head on a pillar, sleeping soundly. The storm hadn't awakened him. He's not in panic mode. He was undisturbed by the waves and the winds that pounded upon this boat. And the disciples, in their state of panic, fear, terror, they wake him up. And what do they say to him? Don't you care that we are perishing? The Message translation says, is it nothing to you that we are going down? Is it nothing to you that we are going down? And Jesus is awake now. But notice the fact that Jesus doesn't say anything at that moment to the disciples. He simply rebukes the wind. With those familiar words that we know all so well, peace, be still. Other translations put it, quiet, settle down. You know, that's more the way I talk to my kids. You know, settle down. And Jesus says to the storm, to the winds and to the waves, settle down. And indeed, as Jesus speaks with swift and sure results, we are told that the wind stopped and the sea was calm, peaceful, peaceful. Jesus rebukes the wind with the same words, my friends, that he has used to cast out demons in the earlier chapters in the book of Mark. The same word to cast out demons he uses indeed to calm the sea and to bring again about peace. And so as Jesus has rebuked the wind, and indeed he now turns to his disciples, and he says to them, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? You know, we might look at that and think, that's a bit harsh. There was a lot of water coming into that boat. They couldn't handle the situation. But was it? Jesus says, have you still no faith? What was it that they had seen that might cause Jesus to ask such a question? We're in the fourth chapter of Mark, but that which had gone before would reveal to us what the disciples had already witnessed. They had seen Jesus' power and authority already. They had seen demons cast out of others. They had seen Peter's mother-in-law heal another. Many others had been healed. A leper had been cleaned. A paralyzed man had been made to walk. A woman with a withered hand, it had been restored. It was done to others. And this, my friends, was personal. This was not what Jesus could do for others. This was their own personal storm. Face of this storm, for them, it's now personal. It's not Peter's mother-in-law. It's us. And now it's time for testing, if you will. Remember Jesus in the wilderness being tested for obedience. A time of testing, if you will. Will all that they have seen and heard provide a faith that would enable them to face an own personal tragedy? The text was really significant for the early church. And it is significant to the church today because it really does say, will the church, the ancient church, the early church, but will the modern today church have faith in the face of a hostile, difficult world? For the early church, it was a time of persecution, when the Jews and the Roman world were beating them up and persecuting them, yes, killing them. We're not likely to face that in our modern times. Unfortunately, persecution might be better than total indifference that we face in our world today. Do we have faith? Will indeed they affirm that Jesus is the Christ, the Lord? Will they affirm that he is the ruler of all nature and history? That he is present with his disciples whatever the age may be, at all times and all places. And yes, that message is still important for us. Important for us to know that we are still called to faith, to trust in the Lord, to know that indeed Jesus can still still the waters of life. But it's for us, not only the church, but it's for us as individuals. Because yes, there are times in life when these storms that batter upon us become personal. It's not about somebody else on our prayer list. It's not about somebody we've read about in the papers or has made great news. It is about us personally. And it comes to us indeed as individual Christians in our times of grave danger, in our times when the human, natural human reaction is just like that of his disciples. It's fear, panic, terror, to wonder whether or not there is a God. You know, people do not want to acknowledge that there are times in life when they might question. Is there a God? And if so, is he aware of my problem? It's personal. It's in allies. It's come home to roost, if you will. And we cry out to God just like these disciples did in the midst of our storm. Do you not care? You know, Jesus was with his disciples in that boat that day. And the good news is that Jesus is present with us in the midst of our lives today, regardless of the storms, regardless of the terror that might seize our hearts. Jesus is indeed in the midst of life today. He can give us peace in the face of sorrow. He changes the darkness of death into the sunlight of eternal life. He gives us peace in the face of life's problems, whether it be our health problems or financial problems or relationship problems. Problems come. That's a given. Problems come. But he can give us peace in the face of those times when we see no way out. He can give us peace in whatever our circumstances may be. When he challenges us to be more than we indeed want to be. When he challenges us to a position or a call that we want to say, no way. I can't do it. He's in the midst of the storm. You have a sign out in front of the church that says, you can argue with God, but you won't win. We need to keep in mind that God of all creation, that God who loved us enough to send Jesus Christ, his Son, is still involved in our lives today. Personally involved. His disciples, we are told, that indeed were awed at what had taken place. Think of all that they had already seen in all of the healings and all of the miracles in casting out demons. But it had come home. It had come home to them. And they were awed. Who is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? We too have to answer that same question in our own lives. We too need to stand in awe, in reverence of the God of all creation. In awe of the God of all creation. And know that indeed He can still the waters of our lives, just as He could still the Sea of Galilee. Praise God. Praise God for His power and His authority and His love. Amen. That is pretty good. Father, we thank You. We thank You for the assurance of all that You can do and Your desire to do it in our lives. Thank You, Father, that You come into our personal situations and You love us through it. Father, we stand in awe. We stand in awe of You. And as we come, Father, to this time of observance of the Lord's Supper, we pray, Father, that indeed we would remember all that You have done in the lives throughout the Scriptures, but that we would remember, Father, all that You have done in our lives personally. Thank You. Amen. Ask the deacons if they come forward at this time. Share with you words of the institution of the Lord's Supper found in the Gospel of Mark. It says, while they were eating, He took a loaf of bread, and having blessed it, He broke it, and He gave it to them and said, take, this is My body. And then He took a cup, and having given thanks, He gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. And He said to them, this is My blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Let us pray together. Father, as we come now to receive the bread and the cup, we come, Father, asking indeed that You would examine our lives, for the Scripture tells us that we are called to be remindful of indeed, Your desires within our lives. So show us, Father. Show us the things that we should do and the things, Father, that we should not. And Lord, we pray that indeed, as You examine our lives, that we would come more and more in line of obedience to You. And Lord, we ask that indeed You would bless this table, bless the bread and the cup. And Father, that we, in receiving it, might indeed be called to remembrance of all that Christ Jesus has done in this world for us, the love that You have shown to us, the grace that You give to us. Father, just bless us. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. The Scripture says that when He is eating supper with them, that He blessed the bread, and so we will indeed receive that now. God provided. The scriptures tell us that even the soles of their shoes didn't wear out. God provided. And when they were hungry, the scripture says that he showered down bread, manna from heaven. And for us, my friends, God sent down Christ Jesus, who says, I am the bread of life. This represents his body for us. Eat this, remembering him. We are told that after they had shared a meal together, that he took the cup and he said to them, this is the new covenant in my blood. I will not share it again, he said, until I share it with my Father. Mm-hmm. We come receiving the cup today, remembering Christ's blood shared on the cross of Calvary.
Thank you.
said to the people of Israel, there will come a day, there will come a day when the covenant of God will be written upon the hearts of men and women. And that day came, my friends, in Christ Jesus, where he said to his disciples, this is a new covenant in my blood. Drink this, remembering him. And we are told that as often as we eat the bread and drink the wine, we proclaim his death until he comes again. And how appropriate for Scripture to end with, come, Lord Jesus. He will, my friends, come again. Let us stand and sing together the first verse of Blessed Be the Tithe. The grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, his Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit, this day and all the days to come. In Christ's name, amen.